And I want to welcome everybody today to our campus for this exciting presentation by Sensalize and others. And I'm going to get into quickly just how Mountain Empire got involved in this. This started a couple of years ago, or maybe it was a year ago, when Jack came down to our office and sat down with us and said, this is something we're going to be working on. How can Mountain Empire get involved? Well, after that discussion, we had discussions here on campus among ourselves, and we began to look at this technology, this area systems technology that is becoming so prominent today. And we saw a real opportunity for Wise County and the whole region, for our entire district, Southwest Virginia, and for the college to really get involved in something that's very exciting and very new and cutting edge, and be one of the first in the state to do that. So we can't stand up a program in just a few seconds. We've got to have some time. We've got to work our way through the bureaucracy. We've got to get a program approved. And since we wanted to go with a credit-based program, it took us a little while to do it. But we wanted to get started right away. So last year, we started a strand in our governor's school on unmanaged aerial systems and drone technology. And we began to introduce that at our governor's school, which included some of the top high school students in our region that come to our campus and go through these different strands and learn some new things and get college credit while they're here. So that was the beginning of it. We got some drones on campus. And one interesting story, we had a group of high school students in our 3D printing strand, and they were interested in putting the drone together. So on Tuesday of the last week of governor's school, they said, well, we want to build a drone and print it out on the 3D printer and actually put it together and make it fly by the end of the week, which is when they presented their things on Friday afternoon. Those students went to work, and with the help of their instructors and Fred Coburn here, he helped them get the motors and things put on. But they designed the frame and printed it out on a 3D printer. Fred helped them get all the motors and electronics put together on that thing, and they were working right up to the last minute, but they flew that thing on the last day of governor's school on Friday after just starting on that Tuesday. So this is really a motivating and exciting technology for young people, and we're very pleased to be one of the first in the state to get involved in this. We are putting together a 24-hour credit program, but we've also utilized this technology and introduced it into some of our other programs here on campus. We saw applications for advanced manufacturing. We saw applications in environmental science, in forestry science, our emergency management services, and other programs here on campus. So it's not just in one area on our campus. We're implementing this technology throughout programs on our campus where it might be used in the future. As a result of these and other activities, Mountain Empire was recognized and received the President's Award from the Southwest Virginia Technology Council's gala in June. So we were recognized for our efforts in innovating new technology here at Mountain Empire. And we most recently have been a partner in a Virginia Space Consortium grant with the National Science Foundation. That's going to give us the resources we need here at the college to get that program stood up, get started, get the curriculum developed, and get going with that credit program in UAS technology. So we're very excited about what we're doing here, and I hope you will all see how interesting this is today as we progress in this presentation. My next job this morning is to introduce Congressman Morgan Griffith. Congressman is with us today, and we appreciate him coming to campus and being part of this. Morgan Griffith was first elected to represent the 9th Congressional District of Virginia in the U.S. House of Representatives on November 2nd of 2010, and is currently serving his third term. Morgan is a member of the House Energy and Commerce Committee, which has jurisdiction over some of the most important issues facing Virginia's 9th District, including public health and federal regulations. For a second term in the U.S. House of Representatives, Morgan was named to the Energy and Commerce Committee Subcommittee on Health. In addition, Morgan serves on a Subcommittee on Energy and Power and the Subcommittee on Oversight and Investigations. Prior to his election to the U.S. House of Representatives, Morgan served as a member of the Virginia House of Delegates from 1994 to 2011, where he represented the 8th District. In 2000, Morgan was elected House Majority Leader, the first Republican in Virginia history to hold that position. Morgan is a graduate of Salem's Andrew Lewis High School and an honors graduate of Emory and Henry College. After completing studies at the Washington and Lee University School of Law, Morgan returned to Southwest Virginia where he practiced law for nearly three decades. He's married to Hillary, and together they have three children. Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome Congressman Morgan Griffin.
Sometimes my hands start to fly. You hope that mic and start doing this. It doesn't work out too good. I didn't have anything to do with this. I'm not going to take any credit for it other than to say that I'm very supportive of it and very excited about what you all are doing. Appreciate the work you're doing here. Jack, appreciate your leadership. I've always been hesitant to step up and say, oh, I had something to do with that when I didn't, and we stand there ready as my office, Michelle Jenkins, my district director's here, I think many of you all know her. We stand ready, willing, and able to do anything we can. And one of the things I've been pushing in Washington, D.C. is that, okay, you all keep telling us you want us to transition our economy. You want us to make a shift. We need help doing that. You cannot destroy one part of our economy, the biggest part of our economy, and then just say, well, it'll just happen organically. So I've been working hard to try to make sure that we have some funds available that may or may not. I think we might be able to, if I get the Senate to go along, I think we may have the opportunity to use some of the money that I was able to get a couple of weeks ago in the House side in some of these projects that your drones are currently working on, which relates to reclaiming abandoned mine lands. At the same time, however, the real excitement here is not just one project. It's the possibility that being a leader in this new field that the world is looking at and that we all are looking at, being a leader there may actually bring about not just great things for the United States and new discoveries of ways things can be used and the way the drones can be used, but an opportunity for Southwest Virginia, particularly this county, to not only take this new technology when we figure out new ways to use it, but to also become a center both research and development of this new technology, of these technologies as it emerges, and hopefully attract industries here that A, see a forward-thinking community, and B, that may want to use this technology themselves in one way or another. That's what's exciting about this. So I come here today, again, not to claim credit for anything, but to let you know I'm here ready, willing, and able, and to thank you all for figuring out things that we can do, because if we continue to look at the same old things, the same old way, and say we're going to do it the same old way, we're not going to move Southwest Virginia forward. So I'm here as a partner. Let me know what we can do as a team to help with you all on this. Now, I do have to take a personal aside because I'm not going to be able to stay because they got me booked going here and there, and I won't be able to hear everything that Dr. Stark, which one is Dr. Stark, by the way, I showed you. I thought maybe it was you, just had that look. Someday when we have time, we need to sit down and talk, because you mentioned in my bio that Hillary and I have three children. The youngest is named Stark. In the 1820s, a Miss Stark married into the family. There's been, not consistently, but over the years, there have been some Starks in the family, and we are probably kin somewhere back in the chain. Now, we might have to get back into the 1600s to figure it out, but we're probably kin somewhere because I got some Stark blood in me, too. So that's my personal side, but again, thank you all for allowing me to participate in this, and I am pleased to be here because, not about me personally, but the office of the congressman means that we're hopefully drawing some more attention to this endeavor, and again, I stand ready to help you all. Thank you all very much. I'm going to stand over here as long as Michelle will allow me before she gives me the hook and says we have to move on and listen. I hope I'll get enough of your comments that I got a really good idea, but I would love to sit down sometime, not just talk about family, but talk about research. Thank you all very much for letting me be with you.
Thank you, Congressman. We appreciate you being here as much time as you're able to spare. Next on the agenda are comments by Mark Blanks, the director of the Mid-Atlantic Aviation Partnership at Virginia Tech. Mark cannot be with us today, but he has sent a letter, and Jack has asked me to share that letter with you, so I will. Can you all hear me down there so I don't have to use the mic?
Thank you.
Good. So, here's Mark's letter. For Virginia Tech's Mid-Atlantic Aviation Partnership is thrilled to be a part of this initiative. We're disappointed that other commitments are keeping us away from this event today, but we want to say how very pleased we are to be involved in this important project. We'd like to start by thanking Mountain Empire Community College, the Virginia Israel Advisory Boards, Sensalize, Hazon Solutions, Wise County, the Wise County Economic Development Authority, and the Virginia Coalfield Economic Development Authority for your contributions to making the last few days such a resounding success. And of course, we would like particularly like to thank Congressman Griffith for his participation today. MAP's mission is to conduct research, development, testing, and evaluation of unmanned aircraft systems in order to assist the FAA with the difficult task of safely integrating UAS into the national airspace system and grow the UAS industry in the Commonwealth of Virginia. This project speaks to both parts of that mandate. We are especially pleased to be working with Hazon Solutions and with Sensalize. We've worked with Hazon from the inception of the MAAP. Sensalize is a new partner for us, and we see both of these companies as having huge potential to grow the UAS industry in Virginia. At the Mid-Atlantic Aviation Partnership, we take that last word, partnership, very seriously. Our experiences have shown us over and over again that partnership is the key to making big steps forward. This was proven last year in Wise County during the Let's Fly Wisely event, when our partnership among technologists, medical providers, and local officials teamed up to complete the first FAA authorized package delivery to the Wise County Fairground during last year's free clinic. This diverse group found common ground and a common goal, and we accomplished an historic first. The team you see before you today is doing something equally important. Virginia Tech and MAP are providing flight safety oversight and interface to the FAA. Sensalize is providing sensors and technology to analyze and display the data. Hazon is providing the platform and the operators. Mountain Empire Community College is bringing the students and providing an experiential learning opportunity. VIAB and Wise County are bringing us all together. And Wise County EDA and BCETA are providing the seed funding. Together, we are planting the seeds of a new industry right here in southwestern Virginia. Using UAS with integrated sensors for monitoring reclaimed lands and an array of other applications will have economic and technological impacts that will extend beyond the flights this week and beyond the stakeholders at this table to all our communities in the years ahead. We are thrilled to be part of this week's events and look forward to continued partnership to build the future of the UAS industry in the region. We know that future will be a bright one. Sincerely, Mark T. Black, Director of the Mid-Atlantic Aviation Partnership. Next, I want to introduce our featured speaker, Dr. Robbie Stark from Sensalize. Dr. Stark serves as the Sensalize CEO and has over 20 years of experience in remote sensing and a solid track record specializing both in developing applications as well as building and operating hyperspectral systems both in the civil and the defense markets. After receiving his PhD from Ben-Gurion University, Israel, Dr. Stark joined Barkal Systems Engineering as a business development manager, positioning it as the leading hyperspectral company in Israel. Dr. Stark played an integral role in the acquisition of Barkal by Elbit Systems, a world-leading defense contractor. In 2012, together with his colleagues, Dr. Yoav Zerd, he founded Sensalize, a data analytics company that integrates high-end sensing, servicing the mining, utilities, and agricultural industries. Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome Dr. Robbie Stark.
Now at this campus, yourself in the last few nights using all your internet capacity to transfer the data to Israel. So I had time to explore the campus at night, very nice. Before I start with the presentation, I would like to thank again for the chance to involve Sensorize in this project. And it is not so common in the world of UAV, this kind of topics. And a special thank again to Jack Kennedy, that is the real one that pushed forward all these kind of things. And we are only just starting with this, and I believe we can take it much higher to do something very big here in WISE. We started to speak about the next steps. So that's it. I'll start. So I would like to start with this map. And this is a story from our past, from when we were working in Barkal. And what you can see here is the gold mine area in South Africa, Vaal River. It's one of the largest areas in the world that they actually mine gold. And I'm telling this story because it's similar to the story how we got to WISE. The issue of environmental monitoring was a very, there was a big concern about this topic, and they were looking for new technologies and new solution how to address. And we were approached by Wits University, it's a well-known university in South Africa, if we can, with our solution, come and assist to map and identify the sources of pollution, monitor vegetation. So we flew here, it's about 160 square kilometers, it's huge area. We flew with an aircraft at 40,000 feet with a hyperspectral airborne sensor, and what you can see is the mosaic and what we provided. So we mapped the vegetation, and what you can see here, it's all the big tailing dams and the Vaal River. And we mapped the vegetation. Now, one thing that we assisted, they're using vegetation in this specific for two reasons. The first one is as a belt around this tailing dam that can stabilize all these slopes and all these tailings. And the second one, using specific species of trees to actually absorb the pollution, all these. There's a big problem of acid mine drainage in this area, and to absorb the pollutant from the ground into the trees. So one of the things that we identify, for example, if you look at this stain of healthy vegetation in a very dry season, very arid zone, the only answer for this could be that it is you have a seepage zone. And by doing this in all this area, we assist them to identify all the seepages, where to go, where to map, because this is a huge area. So from this, this is just give you a perspective of the, and you can do it only when you have the whole picture, looking from above, not going, because usually when you go in the ground, your eyes in the ground, and I was told yesterday how you're doing today the decision about Daniel, help me with the going, looking into vegetation, very not efficient, a lot of resources are involved, so you need new efficiency, new technologies. So what I'm going to speak today is a few words about myself, and I try to, at the end I will get to what we are doing here today, but because we are in a academic institute, I would like to give you some more deep into the approach, into the thinking, how to take something from the scientific world into the real world commercialization. And I call it the right recipe. What are the ingredients that you need to have a working solution? And then a few examples from our experience and about Sensorize, about the team. So, a few facts about myself. I live in the Galilee in Israel, and everyone is excited when I said that I live 20 minutes from Sea of Galilee and 20 minutes from Nazareth, so everyone said, wow. This is where I live. as was mentioned earlier, I hold a PhD from the Ben-Gurion University. I started as a geologist, and I moved in my master's degree to remote sensing, dealing with aquatic environment, later also with vegetation. But all in all, in environmental remote sensing and working for since the 90s, the last century, both in the civil and defense, in these types of work. And I think I mentioned the defense because I think it gives a different way of thinking, perspective, how to approach things. There is, I told Jack yesterday, there is no. You have to bring the solution to those that are interested in the information. So it gives us a lot of know-how that is all implemented in the current solution. So the right recipe, as I see it, we have great technology. Sure, everyone speaks about it. But before running to the market with a drone and a camera and start doing something, I think you have to sit down take in consideration a few things. First of all, you have to have a good understanding about the market you're going, what is the opportunity, what are the needs. And then you also need to take in account all the challenges that come to implement this scalability issue. It's a big issue in using UAVs. And finally, when you have a good picture, you can go, as we said, technology to the solution, because technology is not a problem in the UAS today. The problem is the implementation. Scalability, how to execute it, how to deliver the information to the right user, and hopefully that the user will use it. So, as I see the opportunity, it's all here. The challenge of addressing these kind of topics in the mining industry exists. We are not inventing them, and it's all, some of it related to environmental, some to regulatory. And also, we also identified about the opportunity that you won't find a lot of in the industry addressing this kind of topics. It's non-ag, it's non-media, it's non-homeland security, it is mining. So it's usually like mining it is, its technology is way back at adapting this kind of solution. So that's why we thought that when I spoke, first time we were introduced to Jack by the people, by John Green from MEP, and we're looking what to do here. And the first thing, of course, everyone said, let's go do something with agriculture. And I said, why agriculture? Everyone is doing something, what no one is doing with mining. Let's try, and the match was great because there is a real need in this area. And we have experience in that domain, and we thought that this should be the right way to go. So what actually are some, and most of you are aware and know better than me, these kind of things, what is required, you have to understand the need. So it's if it's related to site remediation, like inspection, identify the right areas, identify the problems. There's an issue that is, yesterday I learned about it, about getting the bond release. It's a big issue here for some of the players. And you have to take in account that you want to look and monitor over time. And this is very important because later on, when the solution is developed, you have to consider this issue. It's not like media that you come once time to an event, take, and that's it. So it implies on the solution, on the sensing and the analytics. All of what you see here requires a lot of resources and require efficiency. If we want to do it by pictures, so you can see some of the questions that are asked. How big is the seepage? If there is a seepage, how successful is the vegetation program? What is the change in productivity? Where are the weak trees, so these kind of topics that currently we address with our solution, we decided to concentrate on vegetation because the applications are vast in vegetation, although we have the capability and the know-how and knowledge to also address issues related to soil, to mapping aquatic environment like eutrophication, algae bloom, these kind of topics. So why to use the UAVs in this kind of market sector? Because it gives us the access, the resolution is very high, you can do what is known as baseline change detection analysis, and you can address real issues using this kind of information like acid mine drainage and to identify pollution. So once it's clear that we really know what to do, there are some challenges that you need to take in when you want to develop a solution. Sometimes economics, the state of this industry, for example, the coal mine industry, what are the regulatory, if it can be used, it will be accepted, this kind of solution by the regulation. And yesterday we spoke about it with the DMME people. And then it's very nice to fly a small drone here in campus, but if you're thinking of flying all over the areas in Wise County only, we want to scale, so you need to think globally and act locally. This is so you have scalability is a big issue. And you know, need to address, I heard there's some areas that are 5 acres and areas of 2,000 acres. You need to have a solution that can address all this. And of course, education. You have to understand the user skills, if they are ready to adopt it, if you need to, if they are ready to accept it, or it will be at the end nice pictures on the wall that happens in some of these kind of technologies. So once you have a clear understanding on that, you can move to develop your solution. And in Sensalize, when we left Elbit System, Yoav and myself, in 2012, we set 1 year at home doing nothing because we knew what can be done with the technology. But in that year, we studied the market, we studied the need. We went to and speak with stakeholders, users in different countries, in different applications from agriculture, from mining, from utilities. And we tried to understand what can we deliver that will be used later. What are the needs in all these markets? So it's very important. So once you think you are ready, have a solution, I think it is important for success that you will be part of an ecosystem. And in Israel is well known as the startup nation, innovation everywhere. And of course, the market that you are addressing has to have to be ready to adopt, as I said, and then the solution. So technology. So, as I mentioned, Israel is a really innovative ecosystem. It starts with the research, well-known institute like the Weizmann Institute, like the Technion. Most of them have few Prize Nobel professors coming from them. There's from the high-tech scene in different areas, Checkpoint, one of the leading in cybersecurity, the Tafim, drip irrigation, the company that brought drip irrigation to the world, Waze is a navigation, social navigation application, and in UAV, Israel is leading. And Sensalize is working with all these names, most of them, and is proud to be part of it. And the second thing is when you go to mining today and you're looking, can you use this technology with mining? So you see more and more big companies, for example, like Cisco, is thinking about bringing IoT, Internet of Things. This is the new buzzword. After big data, you have Internet of Things. It's about connectivity, it's about sensing, it's about analytics all together. So this will be how the smart mine will look in the future. And you see machinery that is going more and more with a solution like these mines in Australia. don't see the hundreds of trucks driving autonomously from the mine to the different site, and of course the use of drone. So in general, there is readiness by the market to accept this kind of technology. So then when we develop our solution and when we wanted to deal with it, we again came with a bottom-up approach that meant that you're not taking a DJI, it's a well-known drone, with a GoPro, and go and map vegetation, or go and map aquatic environment, or soil, or other features. You have to understand, again, as I mentioned earlier, the needs, what are the problems. You have to understand, you have to have good scientific knowledge, and you know what you're doing. You need to know what algorithm to develop to map this kind of problem, to address this kind of problem. And only based on that, this is what we've done. We developed our sensor. I wanted to share it with you. The Robin Eye. Sensor that we are all speaking about. So it's a, what's unique is that it's a application-driven sensor. It was developed specifically to map vegetation. It weighs only 600 grams. It has 8 cameras that are taking pictures at the same time. And what is unique, it's about, and I'll speak later on about the calibration that you can measure over time. So once you have the sensor, you also need to deal with the software. So it's, as you see, it's step by step, brick by brick, building the whole solution. And doing that, we managed to address the whole picture. So also in the software, what we've done, trying to deal with the scalability issue. Aside from that, this sensor, for example, can be mounted on most of the drones that exist today in the market. And even now we are going on military grade drones. So the scalability issue is one thing, and also from data. One of the big problems is how you upload all this data to the cloud. The cloud is the holy grail now. Everyone wants to go to the cloud. But in the last 2 days, we gathered about 25 gigabytes of data, raw data. And you don't need most of this data. So we developed, and this is now in beta, what we call the Robin, the LRP, local Robin processor. It's actually a cruncher on the ground that actually takes all this raw data and build up this kind of mosaic. It's huge map, collecting all the imagery, and then we upload. So we can decrease, remember one flight was 7 gigabytes, one of the sites we flew, and we can increase it to 200 megabytes in minutes on the ground. So this is one thing about scalability, how you deal with that, because we were thinking like everyone, let's go to the cloud. And a year ago, we were visiting a user in 1 hour next to Toronto, and we thought, we are in the first world, Toronto, everything very easy, but we were struggling with the data, and then we decided to develop our own solution. And then when it's on the cloud, this is what we call the Robin Mine, we actually deal with all the analysis and the end, develop a platform to distribute the data to the users, which would be very straightforward. And only after you deal with all that technical solution, you can go to the platform itself. And again, depending on the mission, you need to know what platform to use. What you see on the upper left, this is from 2 days ago, this is the platform we use in Desert. And on the right bottom, this is the platform that we use. Last week, we flew with the French rail company, SNCF. Flying over corridors for vegetation. By the way, the second biggest expenditure of the French rail company after safety is vegetation management. It's about 120 million euro a year. And they believe this, with this solution, we can save up to 10%. This kind of technology assists them in the monitoring of vegetation. So at the end, what you have, we call it a system of systems. You have many systems that are all speaking together, all working together, and then you have the solution. I would like to speak to a few minutes about the issue of sensing. One of the big gaps today when we started this venture of Sensorize was the sensing, and we see it still today. Everyone is dealing with the platform, flying, and the best autopilots, etc., etc. But we see that actually what the user wants, it doesn't matter for the end user. If you, in the army, they use the, on my side, make it from leaves. I don't care how you bring the data. If it's a quad, a balloon, an aircraft, a spacecraft, I want the data, I want the information. This is what's important. So, and there is a big, still there is a big gap today in good sensing technologies, good sensors that can provide the right data that can be used. So, one of the main, and this is, I think, one of the strengths of Sensorize, what differentiates Sensorize is the calibration issue, the modeling. What you can see here, it's two. It's a wheat field in south of Israel, and taken in two different times. And because we have a calibrated sensor, it means that we can compare data over time. And this is very, very important when you go to the industrial world, when you're going to maintenance, monitoring, measurements, like here in the mine here in Reclamation. You want to revisit the area, you want to see, you want to compare, you want to be able to see the changes. This is one of the main issues that our sensing capability is very strong. This allowed us later on, today we are in the era of monitoring, but if we will collect data over time and we'll know what is related, we can go to the era of prediction. And what you can see here is an example. On the left side, you can see a map that was taken out from a combine driving in the field of the yield. This is actual yield numbers. And on the right, you can see our map 5 months before. And you can do this only because you are very sensitive, calibrated sensor, so it works. So we are, this is the first trial we dealt with a prediction of yield. This is a big thing in agriculture, but you have to have good sensing. And the another issue is going quantitatively. When I say I'm hot, maybe for me it's warm, and for you it's cold. You don't feel the same. This is what we call qualitatively. Quantitatively, if I'll say now, I can tell you now it's 28 degrees, you can take it to what you need to do. Either models. So actually, we're providing, and yesterday we spoke about productivity, about biomass. For example, this is a measure of biomass, and we can actually provide the real numbers of the biomass. So all the modeling, all the, it will be much more real value to say what is the productivity now, what is the biomass, what is the development of vegetation. Not, I think it's, or I think it's like that, and another person will take another number. So quantitative is very important. This is the whole solution as you see using the sensor, with all the software I mentioned, the processor on the ground, the robot mine, and the RDP. I'll show you in a minute how what you can do with it. So we try to think on data from A to Z, how to collect the data in the right way, how to deal with, process the data, this is the LRP on the ground, how to analyze the data, this is the Robin Mine in the cloud, and how, most important, you distribute the data to the end user, because otherwise, great data, but people can't actually use it. Tesla is performed several, we are a very small company, however we are a multinational. Israel is very small, so you have to try to look outside. So we started with some pilots like in India with Tata, the big Tata, and knocked on our door, asked us to do a project in agriculture. We're flying these days in France with the French rail company, the French electricity company, some mining companies in France. We flew in the UK. We have projects in South Africa. Next week we're flying in Brazil. We flew now in the US. We have some projects coming in Mexico and in Ivory Coast. So, and most of them are, all of them related to vegetation mapping. The applications are different from mining to agriculture to utilities. They all need information about vegetation. I would like to share with you some examples from what we've done. This is working in, with the Israeli Forest Authority. And we were mapping forests. And this is the, how the data looks from our sensor, what we call the spectral curve, the signature, the fingerprint of the material that we're looking at. And it allows us, with the right algorithms and modeling, new classifications, for example, of trees. It also, but it doesn't, the previous one doesn't interest the user. What interests the user is this kind of very simple map with colors, identifying all the dead trees and all the other trees. You can see that you can look at each tree and the each tree condition. And if there was a for example, corridor of power line going, and you see some red trees close to it, you know that you have to cut them down because they are very weak and they may fall on. So this kind of information is important. This is a project we've done for the with the Israeli Natural Reserve Authority. Here you see a main rail track, and we had to map the different species of trees. From South Africa, what I mentioned before, working, mapping different species of tree and their reaction to biomapping pigments and mapping biomass. We knew, choosing by that, what are the best trees that behave next to tailing, that absorb pollutant, and these kind of issues. About the team, Sensalize was founded in officially in 2013. As of today, we have 6 people. We are a very small company. 4 of them are experts in the remote sensing domain. All aspects from geology, vegetation, soil analysis, and aquatic environment. I think that's it. Now I would like to share with you some slides, some information from the last, from this week. So I tried to put some, to call it the play area, playground, and play. So actually, the project started when I was here in September, I think. And we had this meeting, I remember, the Inn with Jeff and John Green and Mike Sievers. And we were starting to throw ideas, how can we build the project. Related to the mining topic, and with time there were a few more parties that were involved, and a few of them supporting financially, a few of them from the operational, but I believe I covered most of the stakeholders in this specific project. So everyone is here, and this was very important to me when they told me, usually do you have a flight operator? I said, let's put it in the back. Let's find the need, the users, the involvement of research, because this is what we're doing most of the time. So the area that we decided to fly are 2 main areas. One is the northern area, and it's close to, you'll see here in a minute. This is the area, and the another one close to the airport. We're flying the first area in first day. You will see in the picture a lot of rain. It was not so easy, but data was collected. Here you can see some pictures from the field and from the operation. Give you the impression to those of you that were not visiting the field. This is how it looks from the mission planner when we operate the drones in the air. You can see all the flight lines and where's the four circles. It's actually the drone flying. And we see it's like an aircraft, all the information that we can gather. And this is how it looks after we collected all the imagery of this specific area. It's thousands of thousands. Now each point of that, it's about 8 pictures because we have 8 lenses. So multiply all these, you have tens of thousands of pictures that you need to deal with, sort, stitch, do all this stuff. And this is the first mosaic image from Monday. This is what we call the RGB, the true color imagery, and on top of that we put actually our solution. I would like now to move, show you. Okay, so this is the platform that we developed for the end users. This is actually the RGB. What you can see on the left, you can see all the areas that are required to be flown with the size of the area. If I press this is an area as well. This is when we plan the mission. This is actually the polygon that we want to fly, the area they want to fly. And once we fly, we actually upload the data to this platform. You can see how close is our data with the background is Google Earth, but from the next time, this will be the background for using. We won't need any more Google Earth. On the right side, this is the where you can see some of the results. This is very what we starting to do. It's just very preliminary processing, and then this maps will be downloaded to any GIS, geographic information system, by the experts. And together, we based on that, we can start taking decision, deciding what to do and what action are required. I think this is the last slide, and this is by that I finish my presentation. Thank you.
Rather than agriculture. If there was an increased interest shown in this region for various opportunities in agriculture, you could adapt your program to that?
Sure. We spoke yesterday about forestry, we spoke about, it's very easy. The application is vegetation. How to use it, the different market sector, it's not an issue from the side of technology. We can apply different market sectors for different needs.
Thank you.
I was just curious, what altitude was that flown at?
We flew what we're allowed to fly. It's 100 meters, it's about 400 feet. And next to the airport, we flew higher. The ceiling it was 120 meters, which is the highest you can fly. The resolution here is about 10 centimeters per pixel, what you see on the ground. That's about it.
Is your sensor able to identify the different species of trees?
Yes. We've done it. You need some kind of training, and you need some kind of a priori data, but like, we're not coming with, you're not in the military zone that you don't know anything what you're flying at. So you have to, we usually work like in, with the French electricity company, EDF. Now we have a project, so they have ecologists working with us, and by getting ground rules, we train and say, okay, this is this species and it's good for us. Or sometimes, if it's very easy, like I showed in the slide before, we know what is the signature of a pine tree or oak tree, and then we look for all these. It's possible. Yes.
Thank you.
Kind of a two-part question. What do you see as the business opportunities for companies or even new startups here in Wise County and the area for the use of this kind of technology, and what are you looking for in partners, in business partners here in Virginia?
So what the idea here is that there will be a local company based here, Wise County, that will service the needs of this kind of applications, starting here and also expanding beyond the boundaries of Wise County or Virginia. And we did some calculation. There is enough work here only for this one or two application of reclamation to fly full time for a team of a few people with few drones going and collecting the data. Now, the idea of Sensalize is, and this is the model that we are working in other locations, is licensing the technology to the local company, so in supporting them, so they can use the sensors and they can use this analytics. So and with time, some of it we can also, they will be much more professional in doing some basic, because there is, it looks like it's very fast I did it, but there's a lot behind, a lot of know-how. It takes time, many years, and a lot of. But the idea is to have a local hub, total servicing in the whole area, for these one or two companies. As today, I would position the company that is the leader in mine reclamation application, because my best knowledge, no one is really doing that. You hear all the time, the other application, agriculture again, but this is the opportunity rising up from this area, that this is the heritage of this area, coal mining, and this is the topic. So
that would kind of be a pilot for this technology that can maybe be expanded to other industries like agriculture as well, right?
What do you mean pilot?
Well,
what we've done here, it's
not, it's a case study as opposed to a pilot, right?
It's more or less, yes. Yes.
So if you found a really strong partner company here in Wise County, you could establish that as Sensalize's base in the United States instead of, say, Silicon Valley, right?
First of all, I'm not going to Silicon Valley. Maybe for the money, but not, there's no real business there. We like to go towards the business. And it's too early for me to say, yes, I am coming to have an office here, but I think the right way, and also because we are also a small company, although we consider, and when people look where we operate, they're very big, we think that, and this is what, for example, we're doing in Brazil, we are partnering as a local people, local company that is leading, and we support it. Them, and they are actually doing everything, because they know the culture, they know what is required, they know everything. And we are, won't be right for us to compromise and say, okay, I'm here, let's do, because the Israeli way. Yes.
Once you have determined what you are looking for, from the time that you fly over that area till it gets back to that person's desk, what's the turnaround time?
We flew Monday, and I had it yesterday. Less than, now it's still in not fully automatic, 24 hours.
And can you use the same flight data? And if this person was to come back and say, okay, that's good for that, but can you look at it in a different way? You can do that also without reflying.
Yeah, you have the data. It's the, what you're asking is, I have a different question that I need to, the data is there, so you request some research. Like we yesterday, we had a great idea of a research opportunity for the college here. And big issue with this kind of solution is how you deal with topography. And luckily, this region is not the Midwest. So you have a lot of research question, how you deal with this kind of data analytics with slopes in very steep topography. We never done it. This could be because this is the real life. It's not mapping. You have to face, you will have to face it if you want to service. You can't say to the your user, I can fly only where it's easy to me to fly. Like how they do it today, I heard that transit, they do it whenever it's easy to them to walk. So this is question, for example, that need to be addressed. And together with us, I thought that the local company and the research community here, we can build a small research program funded to deal only with this very small, focused, specific question. How to address this to different topographies. I don't have the answer. Yes.
How many sensors does the Robin have, and how long can you stay aloft?
So we have eight.
Eight
cameras. Seven are with different filters for different region of the light, and we have one RGB true color. We get the power from the platform. So as long as the platform, we are not the limiting factor in data collection today. We can store about 30 gigabytes of data on the sensor. So it could be like all what we've flown in these 2 days, if it was one flight, we still had data on it. So it's not, we are not the limiting factor.
Yes, sir. I'm just curious, is there a longitudinal aspect to this? I mean, what customer would you do this for periodically over 5 years? Or, I mean, just to update the status of the land. How long would it continue for each side?
I didn't get the question.
So
this is... This is not my decision, and I think that as of today, we can do it on a weekly basis, monthly basis, yearly basis. The question, sorry, specifically with this industry, it's all by regulation, what the regulators require. If it requires, the regulation was set up many years ago, as I understood. But today, that technology didn't exist. But so either you change the regulation. So we are not the limiting factor. Tell us what, either you are mining or the regulator, what you want us to fly, how often we will do it. It's not a question of us. It's not a technology question. It's more the execution application. But as of today, from what I understand, what we can do, we can fly if you are need to fly twice before the bond release, so we can fly twice and provide the real productivity information or the real information about the trees that is required for this.
I guess I'm asking if there's a before and after. I mean, you get the current state of the site and you come back a year later, or continue a year,
whoever
does it. I mean, maybe not
with the utility. you're working, we're coming on a sometimes a few times a year or yearly basis to the same tracks area or to the same power line area. It's all dependent on the application, on the market needs.
Thank you.
Yes.
Looking at that image right there, can you share your thoughts as to what we're looking at? What does the red indicate?
So what you can see here, you can see the green area is the vegetative area, those that have vegetation currently. The red are most of the bare soils that don't have. And this is only just to visualization of the data. When you download it and you work with it, you can get to much more. There is a difference in the levels of green, difference in the levels of healthiness or biomass of the trees. This just the first impression, without any putting the real know-how and modeling, taking it to okay, I want to get biomass map. This is not a biomass. This is what most of the people have maybe heard. NDVI. It's a very common algorithm, but you need to know when to use it and how to use it. But showing the areas with vegetation, and you see that, for example, if I go here, this is what I see, that this area is much more greener, more healthy than that area. So then you need to start asking the question. And this is why we need to work with the ecologists, with the companies, giving me to understand maybe, for example, under this area there is a soil capping, or here not. Many questions, but this is, it doesn't show what I'm showing you here a lot yet. It needs to be much more processed and analyzed together with the stakeholder to take the real insight from this kind. What it's showing is, first of all, how fast is the solution is working. We flew Monday, transferred the data to Israel, to their cloud. It was processed a day later, and you, as a user, you can see the results. That was just to show how it works. Now what we take this imagery and others and put them all together and start running the different algorithms and modeling and building the story behind what we see. Yes, someone.
Okay. The sensor, is it proprietary to you?
Yes.
You all designed that?
Yeah. It's our proprietary. We developed from the drawing table to what you see. And again, it's three, it's also our three.
Yes.
Well, I know there's a lot of interest in this technology in the world of wildlife research and management, and I'm just curious, is your program, your sensor, able to potentially detect individual animals on the landscape to aid in population estimates?
The question is, you see, it could be, but it will be for the time you fly. And when we're dealing with this kind of application, time is not an issue. You fly, and you want to. You're getting the picture of what you fly just now. Maybe you won't see any animal, maybe there are, yes. But we are concentrating on, they're using this kind of solution. I know in Africa and gaming and all these poaching and all these topics, but it was not meant to be, but it can be done. But again, you need to take in account that it's, you see what you just visited. Maybe there's no information. Yes.
This area is a little bit unique in the volume of surface mining that has occurred in the Colfield counties. Wise County being just one example. It would seem that what could be done in this area would give great interest to a number of stakeholders. Virginia Tech, Mountain Environment Community College, University of Virginia's College of Wise, the elected such questions as vegetation or non-vegetation. If there's vegetation, the health of that vegetation, the topography, availability of water sources, and then the changes in the characteristics of these interests, and that's just to name a very few. At one time, Wise County was very prolific in apple orchards, for instance, prior to the change in the economy and the abundance of surface mining, which disturbed a lot of land. But there's still a lot of orchards out there that have been abandoned. That there's an orchard there, but the trees, you know, what is the health? What's the health of those trees? What's the health of the soil as compared to the health of not of the surface mine soil? So you take a look at is the big question is what I'm getting to, and the big question we all must answer, for which we're all stakeholders: what is the best use in the decades ahead of the land that we have that has not been disturbed and the land that we have that has been disturbed? Orchards, etc., potential industrial use, wildlife support, and all these questions can be answered intelligently with the data that would come from something such as this.
That's true, but this is not a silver bullet.
Sure.
It's not the magic wand. You need to be smart enough to combine the right technologies, the right solution, and find a synergy between, like, using, I don't know if you heard about LiDAR, but giving the 3D pictures of the ground, or radar, or other types of sensing. But yes, this is part of what you're speaking of. And when you want, and this is actually the nature of remote sensing. But again, you need to address this. Once you put to yourself the right question, then we can, the technology people come and say it's feasible, not feasible, what is required. And not the other way that you will see a lot coming with the technology and saying, flying vehicles.
Just thinking about the umbrella question, what is the best use of our land? And then specific questions that would come from that would lead to specific intentions to find answers.
In this specific, if you want to have a really good understanding of what the land today, what can be, you need other types of domains. Here we map many vegetation. We need to also map the soil, for example. We need to map the water environment, the water bodies, to see the whole environment. So our solution today is very focused on these topics. However, you can use what is known hyperspectral. These are kind of sensors that can map all looking at an area, and this is mainly what they're doing in defense, and getting the whole information about an area in all aspects, allowing you to answer your kind of questions. The problem with this kind of technology, hyperspectral, and I worked with it many years, it's very, the data is huge, the skills that you need to deal with this data is very, very high skills in understanding and data analytics. But I believe with time, there is enough to do with this kind of solution and level of technology. And with time, we believe we will progress much more to this kind of sensing and technology that can address all the questions. Because it's the same question that they ask in the defense. I have an area, I want to have you, what you're asking, I want to have all intelligence of this area, what can be done. So you have to have the whole tools, or toolbox has to include all what is required. Today, with our solution, it's missing. It exists in the market, but it to go commercial.
Do you see this as an educational opportunity? I mean, the skill set that is required, you know, where are you going to get your talent from to do this when you expand?
So first of all, most of the people that we are looking specifically for our company have to have some kind of degree in remote sensing. They can come from the natural sciences, and this is the best, how people think going to natural, and it also can come from geography departments, from engineering. So the challenge is, yes, to find, but it's not enough if we want to have a local company here that is really strong. We'll have to have people in that company also, for example, won't be only on the operational side, but also on the analytics side. So maybe some master degree in forestry can address the question of forestry. One or two agronomists that is specialized in fruit plantations, or someone that has a degree in geology that can assist. So the right balance in a local company, this should be supported. I don't know if the local research community can provide this kind of skills. I don't know if you have remote sensing, what level of geography, forestry, I'm not. But you have, when you want to support, it's not. Because then, I think, if you want to differentiate yourself from the others, not just flying drones and collecting data, you have to bring some like brain into the company. You have to have in this local company here a good forestry guy, a mining guy, so they can support. So this is where you can succeed. Otherwise, there's another company doing the same.
Can your sensors take any information on water quality?
Yes.
Yes.
Can very basic deal with eutrophication topics, map algae, different algae bloom, suspended solids, non-organic suspended solids, not dissolved organic matter, not heavy metals. Simple water quality that is not simple, but it's sufficient. And we've done some projects. We're doing now a big project in France of mapping rivers for microphytes, vegetation in water, algae pool, with this sensor. The beauty is that because we are expert in remote sensing, we understand when we develop the sensor, we try to build the right combination of sensors here, the right filters that can address as much as more application. And I think this is also unique when you ask me a question about water. Most of the players in the arena that they get the sense of flying, they won't really understand getting to the deep level of can you do this, can you do that. And I think this is the skills that you need to put into this kind of company. That if you tomorrow will, this local company today is flying for mining, but flying with this kind of sensor, and they will have an expert in the company dealing with another application, forest, agriculture, I don't know, an agronomist, and some user will come, can you do this? You say, yeah, sure.
Yes, yes, Dr. Stark, I'm wondering about the size of your crew that it takes to do this project, because I'm thinking, you know, there's a tremendous potential for jobs in UAS, but I just wonder, 5 people, 15, 20, 1, -3.
We started 2, and the first year we were like 3. And we were looking at, we also were very, as I said, in a mean, very, our financial is not, probably everyone heard about Precision Hawk, hundreds of people, millions of dollars are. We have to deal with what we have. But the core from specifically, we don't deal with operation, so it's one way it's easy. So we're dealing with the data, the information. So the five that we have today, we're starting to feel they are not sufficient. We believe that a company like that would get to about 20 people, more of them in this specific. But if you're speaking about what we're trying to do here, I would see about three teams of three people that are actually doing the flights and being supported as called the back office by, I'm speaking about only professional, about three, four that are domain experts. So this is the size. It could be not more than 15, 20 people company that can do this kind of operation, not only in WISE, but the whole region.
Right, and obviously there could be all kinds of teams doing all sorts of things.
Yeah.
I worked in the decennial census back in 2010, and I can tell you, you or some other company has a job if you will contact the Census Bureau, because I can tell you our mapping, which was a prerequisite for the actual enumeration, was, how do I say this without sounding critical, spotty. So we made a lot of corrections there on the spot, but it would have been a whole lot nicer to have had proper mapping to begin with. I was just wondering if the drone, you know, would take care of that problem.
It's depend on the sensor. Our sensor was not meant to go what there is the domain of photogrammetry, very high resolution, very accuracy imagery locations. We have actually what we do is mapping, but it depends on the criteria for accuracy that is required by the mapping engines. We are not on that level at all. However, for the application that we are dealing with, it's sufficient.
Well, I only mention it because I remember a particular occasion where supposedly a farmhouse and a farm was actually a strip job with a small building on it. So we went there to enumerate. Of course, nobody was there at the time. But it said basically farm, and it wasn't.
Yeah, drones can assist in that.
Although we are considered very remote in this part of Virginia, in this part of Southeast United States, our remoteness has been greatly negated by another program that Jack assisted in bringing, and that's the NASA Develop program, which Wise County sponsors, and we house those students that come from all over the world. Those students, using and becoming informed with technology like you've shown us today, they've introduced to us needs that we couldn't imagine. Needs in Africa for things which we take for granted. Needs in Asia that we take for granted. And as they answer those questions, that's what I was talking about, land use. A term you probably are not familiar with, but is known to some, and our chairman likes to quote quite often, even a blind squirrel will find a nut every once in a while. And so by using this data, we could stumble over something that otherwise we don't have the ability to even take a look at. And that's the beauty of it. And we will have those young minds from over different parts of the world, not just the nation, but from different areas of the world, to help us also see what would be good news.
That's true. First of all, I think that this is also when you're thinking locally, globally. If you understand the needs, I think it should be a great combination of building satellite imagery and drone-based data. You need to know when to use what. Another thing is, if you have this kind of people already here, and I met last time a few of them, I gave them a short talk. This could be also the local force that can grow this kind of profession that I'm speaking in, this the domain that I'm trying to leave them here. I don't know if they are local or not, this kind of people. there is a real opportunity here to combine, we should combine them into this, and we work together because it's all geospatial data information that you need, and it strengthens the solution that we are providing. And about things that you don't know that until you use, this is the examples we're getting every day. Like, I was thinking that we're going to fly also, why not flying a year after the bond was released? What is the vegetation? But there's issues of regulation. Who cares about it? I was, because it's already, it's not in the government, it's not in the mining, it's the poor guy in the, that has the land. But, and the idea here is to show with this technology, maybe the regulation should be changed. Maybe we need to fly a year later. Maybe we need to check that the 400 trees that were put, count them, are real living trees and not just trees. So there is a lot of things that can be done. But
Brian, I have two questions. Going back to Glenn and Mary's question, from your observation, do you believe that the first money app, the monetized application for this technology, could be bond release, i.e. overflight under current regulations or a new regulation under state primacy to overfly and get bond release for the working for coal companies? And not just in Wise County, but throughout Virginia and the nation.
For that, you need to actually adjust. Today there is a big gap between what we can provide with technology and what is the regulation and the story of bond release. That was our idea when we thought about it, that yes, this is a tool that can objectively give the information that is for both sides, maybe not the good sides for the mining, but regulators for the state, that this is what it is today. This is actually, there's no bluffing, and this is the real situation, because in all these areas there's a lot of cheating, bluffing, and not subjective people, what they think. And this is like coming from something from the side, giving the this is what it is. So potentially, yes.
The second question, relating to topography, you said there's some gray areas with topography. Is this something that CentralEyes would be interested or entertain the notion of entering into an MOU, Memorandum of Understanding, with Mountain Empire to do the research to perfect the views on the terrain if the money could be arranged?
It could be discussed, yes. It's a This is a topic that we need to address, not only in this specific application, but in other applications. Like in India, they grow tea. It's very steep, and the software is usually struggling with it. So there's a lot of need to how to do it. It's not. It's crossing.
Questions you'd like to ask, be glad to answer them, but that pretty much concludes our program for today.